14, I'm hoping that you've read it, that you read these in advance, is it's beautiful. It just seems like Helen got clearer and clearer and clearer, or got more and more and more out of the way. And so that it provide a kind of, you know, if you, anybody here a poet? If you're a poet and you begin to get a poem and you get to get a flow that's going on, it can really just be a very beautiful experience when it begins to happen that way. So this, it's marvelous. Let me start off with the introduction and some commentary. On page one. The Holy Spirit uses logic as easily and as well as the ego. So the ego has its own system of logic. And the system of logic that the ego has makes sense to the ego. By that I mean things follow one thing after the other. It seems to have a logical progression. It's just the whole thing's insane, but it's still logical. Except that his conclusions are not insane. By that we mean the Holy Spirit's conclusions are not insane. Because the Holy Spirit sees truly, or sees as God sees. So keep in mind, so the Holy Spirit is the right part of our mind, which enables us to get it exactly right, right? That's who we are, by the way. There is no real distinction, there's no real difference between you and the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is a way of talking about this, so that we can understand that there is this perfect mind, so to speak. I think it's difficult for us to think that we have a perfect mind, you know, but it ultimately, if we're all one, then we do have a perfect mind. That's one of the most important points in the course. You have a perfect mind. It's always been there. That's why my last book is called Perfect Happiness, because once we realize the perfect mind, we would also simultaneously realize perfect happiness. It would just naturally come from it. What more could, how could you possibly be happier than to realize that you are indeed a part of divinity? And you always said, now the really good news again is this is true for everyone. It's always been true for everyone, but it doesn't look that way because there are just so many masks and so many skins, to quote Meister Eckhart, that cover over the reality of the Christ within. So I'll keep reading on this. They take a direction exactly opposite, pointing as clear to heaven as the ego points to darkness and to death. We have allowed much of the ego's logic and have been seen its logical conclusions, and having seen them, we have realized that they cannot be seen except in illusions. For here alone, their seeming clearness seems to be clearly seen. Now this is, Helen and Jesus both like to do this little play on word things. You know, the seeming clearness seems to be clearly seen. So the ego can totally justify its position because it's right. And one of the things that you can be really sure is that if you have what we call righteous indignation, you're wrong. But you can't see that, because what you see, you are seeing clearly. You are really clear that you are right, and the truth is that you are really insane. Okay, but you're right. Right? That's why a little bit later on, you know, the course in this chapter as well talks about the importance of being able to realize that we're mistaken. This is again Bill turning to Helen and saying there must be another way. We got to get to the point of realizing that we are insane in order for this whole thing to change. And for the last sentence there. Let us now turn away from them, these insane ideas, and follow the simple logic by which the Holy Spirit teaches the simple conclusions that speaks for truth and only truth. All right? So all we're really learning here is the Course says that the truth is true. How simple can it get? But we think something else is true. And let's go to bottom of two, the conditions of learning. Indirect proof of truth is needed in a world made of denial and without direction. This whole world is made of denial. The denial is that we are part of God. we're denying our divinity. We deny the whole thing that's we're exempt from that. We don't see it. You will perceive the needs for this if you realize that to deny is the decision not to know. Not to know the truth. Not to know what's really going on. We're hiding out. We're hiding out behind this idea that we don't really know. Remember the line in the Course where it says that everyone already knows. So everyone already knows the truth, but we hide out behind the idea that we don't know. If you would say that you do, it looks like grandiosity. Or it looks like there was a medieval Sufi mystic who went around saying, "I am God," right? And he got his head cut off because of it, right? Because that was blasphemy. You can't go around saying that, and most of us can't go around saying that anyhow. But you know, the truth is still that's the truth inside. And the last line there: if you decide to have and give and be nothing except a dream, you must direct your thoughts unto oblivion. So again, of course, there's tremendous emphasis on this, the dreaming of the world, and what's really going on for almost all of us, almost all the time, is that we are, as a matter of fact, dreaming. That we're not living in the truth of the reality of who we really are. It's a story that we got going on. It's, as I said last time, it's the blah, 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 blah. In other words, it's just the story as we tell the story, whatever the story is, which is very often for us a drama or a soap opera that we're caught in and that we don't seem to be able to get out of. And it seems very real. In fact, as it seems so real that we emphasize its reality, we by talking about it all the time, for one thing, to all of our friends and all of our neighbors and all of, you know, all the texting and all the emailing and all the stuff that we do that just confirms my story. And so I'm stuck in the story, and then that's stuck in an illusion. I really don't know what's really going on as long as I keep this drama going on. Okay, and to page 3. This is, in parentheses, we've used this quote before here, an insane world, and do not underestimate the extent of its insanity. Now, I know you've heard me say before, probably more than once, that the first time I saw the airplane flying into the World Trade Center, the first thought that went through my mind was this sentence. This is an insane world where things like this can happen, right? And do not underestimate the extent of its insanity. This insanity is all over the place. It's inside each of us. It's inside others as well, right? But what's really insane is for us to point out the insanity inside somebody else. Now we got double insanity, you know? What we really need to do is simply to recognize, and I hope that you do this, you have done this, that you simply say to yourself sometimes, "I am insane." I mean, but because you realize that you're not getting the kind of results that you want in the world. You're seeing, you have attack thoughts, you have angry thoughts, you have hateful thoughts, whatever the thoughts are. And as long as we're entertaining those thoughts, we're insane. We are literally mad. M-A-D, mad, is when you're mad, you're mad. Right? You're insane. To finish this sentence. There is no area of your perception that it is not touched. So it's touched every dimension of our society, of our politics, of course, of our religious affiliations and concepts and ideas, of fashion, of any piece of society that we hold up and value and make important and make real. Advertising is really good. Of course, it playing to the ego, and you know, wants this to give us something. And wouldn't it look really great if you were wearing a Porsche car, or whatever it is? You know, whatever. In answer to your question you were asking earlier, Amy, that's the God. That's the other kinds of gods that we build to keep us from our true reality. There is no area of your your perception, it does not touch, and your dream is sacred to you. So this is why the story is sacred, and we don't want to lose it. This is one of the reasons we're afraid of dying. We're afraid of dying because we're afraid if we die, we'll lose the story. And that's true. It's true, but that's nothing to be frightened of. I mean, this is actually something to be really happy about, that you get to be free of the story rather than, you know, having to continue the story. You can't take the story with you into heaven. I don't know how else to explain that. It's that simple, because heaven is where who you really are, in the place where you really are. So how are you going to bring, you can't bring illusions into heaven. Going on. That is why God placed the Holy Spirit in you where you place the dream. So both of these things are in our minds. We have the story in our mind, we have the drama in our mind, we have the dream, and then we also have the Holy Spirit. Now let's be really, really grateful for what we have, the Holy Spirit, because we are trying to learn in this course how to learn only from the Holy Spirit. That's what this chapter is about. It's about listening to the Holy Spirit. I remember very few things that Helen said from having known her, but I remember one thing that she said, and that was that the whole course was about learning how to listen to inner guidance. It's about learning how to listen to inner guidance, because that inner guidance is there. But we can't hear the inner guidance because we got this staticky story program going on, which prevents reception of the truth, because we're caught in the fantasy instead. And the fantasy keeps us from the reality. And we all kind of know this. I mean, we know it underneath. The question is, you know, how much we let the fantasy get played out and how much we don't. I may have to use this illustration. I was one day coming downstairs into our living room. My daughter was lived with us then, and she was watching something on television where young women were pulling each other's hair and screaming obscenities at each other's. And I said, "What are you watching, honey?" And she says, "It's a show called The Real World." This is the real world. Right? Well, you know there's a concept in the course called the real world, which has nothing to do with the fantasy. That's what we call reality TV, right? Well, reality TV is at least one step removed from reality, I mean, two or three steps removed from reality, even further removed from reality than what we normally call reality. It gets even, I met someone who produces these things once. I don't remember where I met her, but at a party or something, and we were talking, and she was talking about how it's all staged and how it has to be staged, and they've got to get them to fight, and they've got got to get them to be angry with each other, otherwise they don't have a story. All right? And then the strange thing is that we find this entertaining. You know, that we want to, it's like the old soap operas from the ladies had their afternoon soap operas. I guess they still exist. But in a less, well, they still exist, right? So let's go to the middle of three. Seeing is always outward. This is very important. Where your thoughts, wholly of you, the thought system you made would be forever dark. Think about that. Read that. Were your thoughts wholly of you? I mean, if the only thing that was happening was the soap opera, if the only thing that was happening was the drama, that the thought system you made would be forever dark. This was not enough, and this is what's going on, say, when we're at war. When we're at war, there is a very dark story that's being played out. It's a terrible, dreadful story. World War I, World War II, I mean, just the terrific. But this still is still going on, of course. But it's also being played out in our workplaces. There's little wars that are going on in one-upmanship and stuff, right? The thoughts the mind of God's Son projects or extends have all the power that he gives to them. So it says, the thoughts the mind of God's Son projects, or so there's two kinds, we'll just review here briefly, of projection. One is the projection where we find fault with the world, and we find difficulties, and we're seeing all the error. It's very easy to see the error because it's all over the place, and pointing it out to each other. And what we're pointing out to each other is how stupid somebody else is, how much error there is that's in the system, whatever the system is, right? Or extend. So there's two kinds of projection. So the one kind of projection is just the projection that we attack with. And the other is the extension of love. Now this is the positive side of the thing, where this is where we give our love away, where we really are altruistic and we really are giving and we are really learning the principles of this course. By learning the principles of this course, there's a section in here, section 5, that we're going to get to in a moment called the Circle of Atonement. And I'll explain that when we get to it, about how this process of giving and receiving and forgiving and being forgiven, it all ties together. As we begin to extend the right kind of a mind, which is there for all. We have two minds. We have a wrong mind, a right mind. So the question is, which one is dominating? And not only this, which one is dominating, but then am I learning how to let go of the insane mind so that I progressively become more and more sane, reasonable, rational, understanding, right? The ego does not understand. Fact is, let me read you a line. This is from chapter 14, but it's not here, I don't think. This is, to accuse is not to understand. And that's, five words. How clear can that be? To accuse is not to understand. So whatever we're accusing, we haven't gone deep enough into understanding. We get stuck at the point. It's enough to just see that we see the problem and we point out the problem and we let it go at that. Okay. back to the middle of 3. The thoughts he shares with God are beyond his belief, but those he made are his beliefs. Now let's talk about beliefs for a second. So one of the places that we get stuck or we get caught is in our belief systems. So we make up belief systems. So the Catholic Church has a belief system, and Islam has a belief system, and Democrats have a belief system, Republicans have a belief system, and we just make up all these different belief systems, and then we buy into believing in the belief system, and it's just a belief system. It's not what's true. But then we get into fighting about the belief system, and which is the better belief system. So are the Republicans got the better belief system, or did the Democrats have the better belief system? And, you know, we can go back and forth about this for hundreds of years, which is what we've been doing. And the same thing is true with religion, or the same thing is true on a whole variety of how we run this corporation, or any number of different places we can get stuck in between the two positions and then battle over them. The problem is the battle. The problem is thinking it's so important that we have to fight and win. Sometimes, I think I said last time, it's much better to be wrong. It really is. Or not to have a position, not to be ever on the attack for any reason. then I have a quote from Ken at the bottom of 3. The Course is trying to help us to understand how much we do not understand. I love these little beautiful little quotes from Ken, right? It's trying to help us understand how much we don't understand. We don't understand a lot, and we think that we do. We think that we understand. That's our position, that we've got it. We're clear. Other people are idiots, but we have got it, right? I mean, after all, we understand the Course in Miracles, right? But the Course in Miracles does not attack. That's the advantage of the Course. We do never attack, right? And if there is an attack, it's definitely a misperception, okay? Even if you're right, okay? To say that seeing, going on to page 4, to see that seeing is always outward means simply that projection makes perception. It's always what's on the outside. That's why the Course spends so much time trying to help us to, and repeatedly using words like look, watch, be quiet, go inside, listen. It's asking us to meditate on the workbook lessons, to spend time with them, to just sort of sit with it, to let it sink in, let it seep into us, which it can do very, very slowly. Okay? And then again, to quote Ken, the only problem in our minds is the belief that we have a problem in our mind. It's the same thing that I've been saying. It's the belief that there's a problem in the mind. You know, if there's no problem, then you really don't have a problem. I think I told you, and I've shared before, but I'll just, without going into any detail, when I had encephalitis and I was in a coma and I came out of the coma, I spent about 4 or 5 days in this really beautiful place. It is just, somebody sent me an email this week about a stroke that they had. And how this is a little bit like Jill Bolte Taylor's stroke of insight, but this was another woman who had a stroke, and how she lived in this really beautiful place with the stroke for a while, right? Because the brain switched process, and there was just this presence. There's just this wonderful presence, just this beingness, without any kind of planning or there were no problems, there was nothing going on, there was just witnessing and seeing, but not in a projective sort of way. Actually, in a receptive sort of way rather than a projective way. So as I've said before, this is the difference between a mystic and the ordinary person. The distinction between mystic and ordinary person is the ordinary person is projecting. We're always projecting. That's what we do. We're projectors. Whereas the mystic is receptive. They just see. But there's no evaluation. There's no interpretation. There's no good and bad. There's no nice and not nice. There's no pretty and ugly even. Even pretty and ugly. Even pretty, right, is a judgment that we throw on top of something, right? And we might say that for a whole variety of reasons. All right. So let's go on down to the bottom of 4. So the Course says, beliefs are of the ego, knowing is of God. That's very important. So beliefs are things that we make up, just as we make up the world. And that exact quote from the beginning of chapter 21, projection makes perception. The world you see is what you make it. So it's just as we make it up. And let's be true, we all wear makeup. We kind of wear makeup all the time. I quote from Ram Dass, I don't have it exactly right, but it's much of our time is spent trying to convince the other person that the mask of our personality is on straight. Yeah, we got the mask on straight. Right? It's on right, right? Otherwise, we're worried that it's not. This is an aside, but I don't think my wife will mind me telling this. We were recently in Brazil, and on the beach, our hotel was on the beach. I was there doing some talks, but we were. Anyhow, women, I guess you know in Brazil, do not wear bottoms on their, they just wear these thong things, right? And my wife was embarrassed that she was the only one there with a bathing suit on. And she said, they can tell I'm an American, can't they? Because it wasn't fitting in with the belief system. You know, that particular belief system is just, you know, it didn't make any, after a while you get really used to it, and it doesn't really make any difference because it's just the way everybody is, the same way. So it really doesn't matter, except we make it matter. Where God created life, there life must be. In any state apart from heaven, life is an illusion. Another way to say this is to say that all there is heaven. That's all that there is. That's why this whole thing is a dream, and that's why once we realize heaven which can be done while one is still alive and in the body, we really let go of the whole illusion of what we call this world. At best, it seems like life, at worst, like death. Now, at best, it seems like life. So, you know, in the happy dream, when things are going pretty well, it seems like life. But for an awful lot of people, this life seems like death. By death, but I mean hell. I mean, it's really not a happy place, and they really don't prefer not to be here. But it's like you don't have a choice. You ever had that thing that you don't have a choice? You know, you just have to put one foot in front of the other and just keep living the life and keep doing whatever it is, because you'd really like an exit, you'd really like an escape, but you're not going to do the Robin Williams thing, or, you know, so you you just keep hanging out in it, even though it's, well, in Robin Williams' case, I guess a place of great depression, deep depression, right? And despair. A little further here. Yet both are judgments on what is not life. Both the life in terms of the life I'm making up, I'm saying that is life, and the life I'm making up in terms of saying that it's rotten, that it's awful, that I wish I wasn't here. Equal in their inaccuracy and lack of meaning. They're equal in their inaccuracy and lack of meaning because they're both illusions. Either way, it's an illusion. Life not in heaven is impossible. And what's not in heaven is nowhere at all. Again, nowhere at all means it is a dream. And one of the ways that we all know that we're going to know this is when this thing that we call life has ended. And then there's an opportunity for heaven, there is an opportunity for something else. And then this will be gone. I mean, it will really be gone. There's not even going to be any nostalgia, I don't think. You want nostalgia about a dream? It maybe seems like that we would want that sort of thing, right? But that, not in terms of the Course. That's not what's going on, right? Okay, outside of heaven, only the conflict of illusion stands. The conflict of illusion stands. Senseless, impossible, and beyond all reason. And yet perceived as an eternal barrier to heaven. The illusion seems like an eternal barrier to heaven. We just can't break through this illusion. And one of the things that we do is we keep feeding the illusion. And by continually feeding the illusion, that's why we can't break free from the illusion, by continually playing into it. Let's go to the happy learner on 5. The Holy Spirit needs a happy learner in whom his mission can be happily accomplished. So one of the things that should begin to happen with you as you do the Course and as it begins to work, as I've seen it working in this guy on the corner over here, is that as you get this, you do get happier. I mean, you do get clearer, right? And you know that it's working. That's the exciting part. There is less despair. There is less drama. There's less of being caught up in garbage of the world. So, and you see it working. You see, because you're free in your mind. Your mind is free. That's the thing that's free. That's the only freedom that there is. It's the only thing that matters, is how we see whatever it is that we're seeing. The Course, again, is all about how to see. And not the outside, but how to see the kingdom of heaven is inside you. We're just recognizing that it's already there. Outside of heaven, only the conflict of illusion stands. Did I read that already? Senseless, impossible, and beyond all reason, and yet perceived as an eternal barrier to heaven, illusions are but forms. Their content is never true. Let's talk about form and content for a moment. So form is anything which is external. Form is anything which has a form. It's anything which is concrete. It's anything which is defined, which has definition to it by some sort of a tombstone as a form. Anything has a form, right? And again, it's something that's on the outside. Our bodies have form. And that's one of our problems is that all we tend to see when we see each other is we see bodies. And the Course is asking us really not to see body, or you can't help seeing a body, but I mean to see beyond the body, to see the Christ within. And that really happens through the eyes more than anything else, probably with a body part of us, right? That we can begin, or it doesn't have to be just that way. One could be perfectly blind and have a tremendous ability to see like Helen Keller did, right? In fact, it's the fact that she didn't have external vision was the thing that enabled her to go inside and find, she once said, I thank God for my handicaps because through them I found my life, my work, and my God. What a thing to say. I thank God for my, and she had two handicaps, as you know, she could neither hear nor see, right? I thank God for my handicaps because through the handicaps, which that's not what she said, through them I found my life, my work, and my God. My God, that's awfully beautiful. So she gets to be enlightened through this process that none of us would want to have to go through, and yet nevertheless it's there. Because when there is no, think about this, there is no outside to distract you. I mean, there's no outside to either hear or see. Later on, when we're going to look at some of Brad's, during the break, we're going to let Brad's pictures run, and there's one particular picture I'd like to, whether we can stop on it, it's the one of the prison inside of the,
sure.
Okay, if we can stop it on that one and talk about what, well, the time will come. This is a prison cell, and I'll tell you the story behind the prison cell, that particular cell, nonetheless. Let's go on. You who are steadfastly devoted to misery must first recognize that you are miserable and unhappy. Now, I said that a few moments ago. Again, that's like Bill saying to Helen, there must be another way. Otherwise, we just continue to wallow in our misery. That's why sometimes the misery has to get really, really deep before you're willing to say it's got to stop. As anyone who joined Alcoholics Anonymous, let's say, at some point, that only happens because your misery became so horrendous with that habit that it just had to break. It had to break. And then it does break. And then after a while, you begin. I have a friend once who was a member of AA said to me something about that he, and others of you may be able to testify to this, that a few days after he'd really, really, really stopped, there was this incredible clarity that came into the mind. He didn't even know this kind of clarity was possible. He didn't know you could think with that kind of clarity. I mean, it was because everything was always muddled, and it was muddled with a guilt, among other things. The guilt makes things very, very muddled. Because, and especially that is hell if you think that you can't break it, if you think that you're stuck there, and there is no door, there is no out. And let's go to the bottom of five. So judgments makes us miserable, arrogance makes us miserable, anger and attack makes us miserable, being right makes us miserable, and all of these are things that we think, you know, like being right is important, that our arrogance or whatever. And on the very bottom of five, the ego's purpose is to perpetuate separation. That's the purpose of the ego. Underline the word purpose. The Holy Spirit's purpose is to undo guilt. In other words, to get us out of this sense of separation. We continue the sense of separation, we continue the sense of guilt, or we begin to undo that, in which we find out that we're actually not guilty. Going to top of six. A little piece of glass, a speck of dust, a body or a war are one to you. For if you value one thing made of nothing, you have believed that nothing can be precious. And you have learned how to make the untrue true. So we make something valuable. And I use as an illustration here a diamond or gold or any rock. We take these rocks and then we say that these rocks have great value. In this world, these rocks do have great value. And I put this, you see, you know about Lucy that I put in here? I was listening to a cosmologist talking on television one evening. I went and looked this up on the internet. This is all true. There is a star in the constellation Centaurus named Lucy, after Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds from the Beatles song, which is actually a diamond, which weighs 5 million trillion trillion pounds. I don't know what 5 million trillion trillion pounds is. In other words, it's a diamond equal to 10 billion trillion trillion carats. And what value is this? Nothing. It has no value because it's so far away that, you know, it's so many millions or light years or whatever it is that we'll never know anything about it. And it really, it doesn't matter, right? It doesn't matter because it is matter. That's the important point. It doesn't matter because it is matter. Matter doesn't matter. The only thing that matters is the formless. What is formless? Love is formless. Knowledge is formless. Real knowing, we're not talking about factual knowledge, but knowing God, if God is formless, God doesn't have a form. If there's nothing about it, it's not on the outside. That's why it's so difficult for us to see this. So even in the most magnificent Taj Mahals and the structures that we can build with all the grandeur that we can use to build them, it's just a form. And all of it at some point will turn to dust. So we have things that we have that we treasure, maybe mementos or things from our past or from our parents or whatever, and you know, it's important to us, right? And the truth is that at some point that's all going to be dust. Because it's already dust. Our bodies are already dust. they're ashes or they're back in the earth, whatever it is. I mean, it's and that has no value either, right? And then I tell this story here. I may have told this story before, but I'll tell it again because it's here. There's a story about a fellow who is very fervent in his prayers, and he keeps praying to God to talk to him. And nothing happens, but he's very, very fervent. He keeps praying, please talk to me. And finally, one day, God says, okay, what do you want? And he says, when I die, I want to bring something with me to heaven. He says, no, it's forbidden. You bring nothing, nothing. That doesn't work. He says, but please, 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 please. And all right, I'll make one exception. In this case, you can bring something. Okay. He immediately goes out, turns everything he has into gold bars, puts them into a suitcase, puts it beside his bed. The day comes when he dies. He shows up pearly gates with the suitcase filled with gold bars. And St. Peter says, you can't bring that in here. He says, no, I have permission from God. And he says, I don't believe. He says, no, go ask God. And he goes, God says, oh, yeah, I forgot. I did make an exception. In this guy's case, I did say he could bring one suitcase. He says, but you got to look inside first and see what's in there. And St. Peter opens the suitcase and looks in and sees the gold bars and says, you brought paving stones? All right. Let's go to the top of 7. The Holy Spirit, seeing where you are, but knowing you are elsewhere, begins his lesson in simplicity with the fundamental truth, teaching that truth is true. This is the hardest lesson you will ever learn. And the reason it's the hardest lesson we'll ever learn is because we continue to remain fascinated with the illusion. We prefer to look at the illusions over the truth. Simplicity is very difficult for twisted minds. And we're pretty twisted, right? Consider all the distortions you've made of nothing. All the belief systems and the things, the diamonds, the jewels, the clothes, the fashions, the whatever, you know, that we make important. All the strange forms and feelings and actions and reactions that you have woven out of nothing. For example, all the grievances that we have with each other, that we weave. We've weaved this together as though it's something. And we're just really failing to see the love that's really in there, that's inside everybody. The simple and obvious are not apparent to those who would make places, palaces, and royal robes of nothing, believing they are kings with golden crowns because of them. And I mentioned below this a phenomena that we all kind of, we try to, exteriorly speaking, look at these things. Some of you may remember back in the 80s and throughout the 90s when we were going through a period of prosperity, there were a lot of McMansions that were being built around, or these kind of Hummer houses, or Persian palaces, or starter castles, or... well, these are just different names that have been given to this phenomenon. They kind of were all, they're called McCastles because they're kind of came out of the same print, a style. And it's interesting. I remember flying into, I think it was Huntville, Alabama, on an airplane one day. And looking, they were just all over around Huntville, Alabama. Out in the outskirts. You know what I'm talking about, right? Well, actually, where I live up in the country, not too far away from where we're there, there are several of these that have been built. And one of the grandest of all is owned by a movie star that I won't mention the movie star's name. And there is actually a yellow Hummer sitting in the driveway all the time. And I happen to know this place is in foreclosure. You know, and it's all going to rust. I mean, you know, it's just all turning to dust. Because it's never there. It's never, you know, Jesus in the Gospels repeatedly says, you know, put up for yourselves not treasures on earth where moth and rust consume, where thieves break in and steal, but put up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust can consume, where thieves cannot break in and steal. The Course is always talking about your creations, right? But it says you are not of this world. Your creations are not of this world. So what is a creation? And they're saved for us. You read these passages about these creations have been saved for us. Well, these are all the love and all the generosity and all of the wonderful sharing and all of the trueness that's inside us that will always be there. So, and I'm one more illustration. It's about selling stars. I don't know if any of this is just another example of. Do you ever see one of these Who's Who books? Who's Who? Well, there's a Who's Who for everything. There's Who's Who for in real estate. There's Who's Who in the stock market. There's Who's Who in theater. There's Who's Who in psychology. There's you know, if you're in any kind of profession, there's a Who's Who book for you. And it's very easy to get into a Who's Who book. All you got to do is fill out a form and send your bibliography and $100. And then your name gets put into a Who's Who book. And you get to put it on your bookshelf along with everybody else whose name is in the Who's Who book. And it's nothing. It's just a list of names. That a whole lot of people paid like $100 a piece to have their name put in the book. Right? That's the way it works. This is a money-making thing that the people who write Who's Who books do. All right. We're going to take our break here in a minute, but let me stop and see if there's any questions before. All right, so we can have a little bit of dialoguing here before we take our break. I don't mean to be hard-ruled about this, because I said the second session I do want to do it. If not, we'll just go straight to break. Okay, let's go to break. Okay, David would like to share an experience with the word disappointment.
Yes.
Right into it.
Thank you.
Is it on?
Yeah.
No, it's not on. Sorry about that. Okay.
Yes, I have an office in Morristown, New Jersey, and from time to time, being somewhat of a workaholic, I'll work in my office on Saturday, and this one Saturday, I was there about 1:30, 2 o'clock, and, you know, naturally getting a little hungry. So I said, you know, I really like a hamburger. So there's this one restaurant I went to, and I said, well, how's your hamburger here, you know? And he said, oh, this hamburgers are great. We have the best. You have to try the Nova Scotia hamburger. It goes on and on. So I said, all right. So I'm sitting at the bar, and I ordered a hamburger. And I said, you know, I'd like some, maybe, fried mushrooms and, like, French fried onion ring with it. No problem. So I ordered a beer. I'm drinking my beer. And it's, like, taking forever. So this hamburger comes out, and it's on this, like, humongous roll, like bigger than a Kaiser roll, and the hamburger is like a little tiny thing, and on top of it is one onion ring, and in the middle of the onion ring is some fried onion, fried mushrooms. And I'm saying, you know, I could have gone home and made a great hamburger. This thing is terrible. And I'm eating it, it's overdone and everything, and I the guy comes up to bar guy. So how's the hamburger? I says, this is one of the worst hamburgers I ever had. So he said, well, you should have told me. Like it's my fault. I didn't tell him, you know? So I went out of there, and I'm thinking, you know, I think I even overpaid. And I'm driving home, and, you know, I know a lot of people in Morristown, so I thought, I'm going to talk to that owner of that restaurant. And I'm going on and on. And I'm saying, well, wait a minute. I created the whole thing.
Of course you did.
I had the appointment of what this thing should have been like.
Right.
And it came out totally different. Now, maybe someone else goes to that restaurant, and they think that's the best hamburger they ever had in the world.
Yeah, that's a good example of the appointment, disappointment here. You're going to do this, Eric.
Yeah, and when you're talking about words, hard is a word.
Hard.
It's going to be hard.
Hard, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And one thing I hear with the course so often is it's very simple, but it's not easy.
Right.
And nothing's easy if I think it's not going to be easy or if I think it's going to be hard.
Right. Good. Why don't you give that to Brad and keep that? Okay, hold on. All right. So we can have more discussion now, but I'm also going to start with page 8 in the booklet on the decision for guiltlessness. This is really talking about a real important concept which we've been talking about all afternoon. But it's the concept of decision making. Okay. Each hour and minute. Even every second, you are deciding between the crucifixion and the resurrection, between the ego and the Holy Spirit, which really just means that you are deciding. David decided to be crucified by a hamburger. Or the resurrection. This wholly new way of looking at things, the salvation methodology of looking at things, which more like what it is, what it is, kind of a philosophy in that particular sense, right? So the ego is a choice for guilt. The Holy Spirit is a choice for guiltlessness. Now, there's how simple can you get? It's just whether we're choosing for guilt, but guilt. Another word we could use here is separation. We're choosing to feel separate or we're choosing to be separate. And a good example with words, how we choose to make that decision would be to lie. That's a good way of separating, segregating ourselves off from, we've now put a wall between ourselves and the person that we've just been talking to. Or we make a decision for guiltlessness, just to be our simple selves, again, in this case, tell the truth. There could be many other illustrations of that. Right? The power of decision is all that is yours. Now, notice the underlining, I put that there, is all. The power decision is all that's yours. And we are always at the point of decision. Every second, every hour, even, you know, even every second, it says, every day, every moment, we're at decision. I mean, the decision is, what decision am I making? Am I making a decision for separation? Am I making a decision that's going to cause me to feel more guilt? Or am I going to overcome this whole thing? What you can't decide between is fixed because there are no alternatives except truth or illusion. That's it. It's just, which way am I going to go? Guilt, guiltlessness, truth, illusion. That's it. It's a simple choice. In that sense, it's a simple choice. And there's no overlap between them. Either I'm choosing right mind or I'm going with the wrong mind. Either I'm choosing with ego or I'm choosing with the Holy Spirit. One or the other. There's not like a gray area in here. Because they are opposites which cannot be reconciled and cannot both be true. You're either guilty or guiltless, bound or free, happy or unhappy. So if I choose for the ego, I'm choosing guilt. Actually, guilt, ego equal the same thing. And then if I'm choosing for the Holy Spirit, I'm choosing for the guiltlessness. And I talk about the word fasting and there a little bit. I want to also skip, if you don't mind, up to section 5. That's in the middle on page 14. The only part of your mind that has reality is the part that links you still with God. This is the only reality. Leave the world of death behind and return quietly to heaven. There's nothing of value here. There's nothing of value here. And everything of value there. So again, it's a matter of what. So let me explain a little bit what the circle of atonement is. The circle of atonement is. Imagine I'm just drawing a circle here. And the way the process works is that as I forgive, so am I forgiven. As I give, so do I receive, right? As I attack, so do I feel attacked, or I think there's justification for the attack. It's just, but it can work either way. But as we give, so do we receive is the best way to understand it. As we create, as we love, and the process, the task in the course really is to do the course enough by doing the workbook lessons, etc., that this begins to become an automatic process. So that it just starts working and then you don't think about the process. It's not a conscious, in the beginning we have to be conscious about it, like if you're breaking a habit, right? In the beginning when you're breaking a habit, you have to be really conscious about the fact that you're breaking this habit. You have to deliberately not do something to facilitate breaking this habit. But then after a while, you begin to lose the desire for the habit. And in that sense, it becomes automatic. It's just not, it's the impulse isn't even there anymore. But you've got to do it enough. You've got to make the choice enough times to get to the point where you don't let the left hand know what the right hand's doing. You see a need, you respond to the need. Let's get the microphone to, here we go, to Barry.
Speaking about breaking a habit, seems to me that the Course is really teaching to be still and know that I'm God.
Yes.
And I have had an experience a couple of years ago of experiencing the stillness within me. And yet I break the habit a lot of times. Sure. And I forget about it. But
of course.
What I made up my mind to do is not lose sight of the fact that there's stillness within me.
Okay.
And when I do that, I was telling someone, Eric, during the intermission, that I used to feel very, very tense with a particular person who I've known since college days. And I made up my mind when I was going to be with him for a considerable period of time to be with the stillness within me. I was going to really concentrate on that. And it worked very well. I felt calm with him.
Yeah.
And
good.
Oh, you also mentioned briefly about guilt and dealing with that. I had a terrible experience Thursday in my doctor's office. I was feeling irritable, a little depressed, because I thought I had to go on medication. And there are two young ladies who were secretaries. One of them gave me the wrong information about something, and I became even more irritable. And I forgot about the stillness within me. It never even occurred. But I got to go back to it. I'm very determined to be more and more with the stillness in me. But anyway, I said to these young ladies, I allowed my irritation to get the better part of me. And I said things I deeply regretted. I felt so guilty about them. So how did I decide to remove this guilt? I went to Macy's to buy them both a gift card. And when I see them, I'm going out of my way to see them next Thursday.
Wonderful.
And I'm trying to find the right words to apologize for my poor choice of words.
Good.
And I'm sure by the time Thursday arrives,
yeah.
I don't even have an appointment.
Right.
I'm traveling from Brooklyn to Queens, an hour and 40 minutes on the damn train.
What kind of train?
Well,
that's the D train?
Close, it's the F train.
Oh. Couldn't have planned
if
that.
If I may say something soon, I've learned from my previous spiritual practices that the mind just wanders.
Right.
And I once asked one of the teachers, he asked me a question about why do you think your mind wanders? So I thought about it and I said, because that's its nature. He said, no. He said, it's a bad habit we all learned, or I learned a long time ago.
Right.
So
that's perfectly in keeping with the Course. Actually, everything you've been saying.
To me, it seems like the Course can be summarized, be still and know that I'm God.
Yes, you could. Yes, it says that. Right. Yeah, very often at the end of a workbook lesson, it'll say, now be still. Right? I mean, and listen, look. I mean, everything that you did there, including the fact that you're going to apologize, that's a very good thing. It's wonderful that you made that choice. But you're also seeing that you can lose it, and so you can get it back.
What are you to do when you're in such a remorseful state?
You stop
that
it.
I said these terrible words to these two young ladies.
So?
I mean, I couldn't stand being in that state.
Of course not. That's the point the Course is making about, you know, you don't realize how miserable you are. We do these miserable things, and then we have to be free of it.
Maybe it was the Holy Spirit that said,
probably was.
Go to,
yeah.
I'll go, all of a sudden, I started thinking about it. I'll go to Macy's, I'll buy them both a gift card and apologize.
And they'll feel better and you'll feel better. I like it. Okay. Let's go to page 25 for a moment. And in the middle, creation is the natural extension of perfect purity, your only calling here. So the only calling here is creation. Or another way to say that our only function here is to do what Barry is feeling compelled to do, which is an act of love or an act of charity, right? That's the creation. Is to devote yourself with active willingness to the denial of guilt in all of its forms. To accuse is not to understand. I read that earlier from just flipping over to the book. And let's go back down to the next part. Teachers of innocence, each in his own way, have joined together, taking their part in the unified curriculum of the atonement. There is no unity of learning goals apart from this. This is a very important emphasis in the course, is on sharing. And it's a positive sense of what that's the thing that gives us the sense of unity. We're working together. We only can get into heaven holding the hand of someone we've helped and of someone that's helped us. Right? There is no conflict in this curriculum, which has one aim, however it's taught. Each effort made on its behalf is offering you the single purpose of release from guilt to the eternal glory of God and his creation. Now see, this guilt thing has keep coming up time and time in chapter 13 and here in chapter 14 too. It's all a matter of finding freedom from the guilt, which we create. The essential guilt is that we think that we're separate from God. Or we think that we can be, and that's the guilt. The guilt is that I could do something against God. You can't do anything against God. God cannot be offended or upset or attacking. The Old Testament God can get upset and attack and offend, you know, be insulted, but none of that is true in heaven. There's no truth in that. And let's go to 16 for a moment, the top of 16. The journey that we undertake together is the exchange of dark for light, of ignorance for undoing. Now that's again the circle of atonement. Is the exchange for we bring the darkness up to the light. We have to bring the darkness up to the light. We don't really know what the light is. We know a lot about what the darkness is. We know a lot about the darkness because that's where we live. So we bring, but so that we know what it is and that we can bring up to the light, and then the light dispels it. But you got to bring it to the light. You can't keep it buried. This is Freud's major discovery. Repression, the stuff we bury that we don't want to look at, that we're afraid to look at. Going a little bit further here. It is only in darkness and ignorance that you perceive the frightening and shrink away from it to further darkness. And yet it is only the hiding that can terrify, not for what it is, but for what it's hidden. So the Course is repeatedly asking us to bring our secret sins and our hidden hates, to be willing to look at them, to bring them to the light, and once we bring them to the light, and it's no big deal, really. They just disappear. They just dissipate into nothingness. David, let's skip David.
Barry, you want to have a microphone?
Yeah, here. Thank just you. There you go. I think it's still on?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's kind of right on point of a question I had here, and I'm going to read a sentence from the Course.
Okay.
The Holy Spirit asks of you but this, bring to him every secret you have locked away from him. I mean, sort of the implication is that maybe we should undertake some therapy to get some of our hidden secrets out. I tend to doubt that that's what's being referred to here.
Right, it's not.
How do we be true to ourselves and unearth our secrets and our darkness?
Okay, so unearthing our secrets and our darkness doesn't mean you go tell somebody else about it. It doesn't mean you got to go to a therapist. Now, there's nothing wrong with going to a therapist, you know, especially if it's a loving, kind, wise therapist like Ken was, who can help us to have a better way of seeing things. But we're really talking about just doing it for ourselves. You know, being willing to look at the stuff that we are, our anger, our attack thoughts, our negativity, all those words that I was going over a while ago. I mean, just to look at the feelings that are associated with those words and to be willing to expose that. And it just disappears. I mean, it's just gone. There's so much of the Course is really just, you get really, Barry's right about this, be still thing and know, because it just, you just get quiet. I mean, you just get quiet in the presence of somebody else attacking you, or insane talking or thinking that's going on around us. That's the mochao, just that quiet observing. You see it, but you're not distracted by it. And this is very helpful at work. You know, you're seeing things, insane things going on in your work environment, and you're not letting them, or in the family, or just any in a restaurant, under any circumstances. Lily Katz?
Something that's been very helpful for me is this book, The Artist's Way by Julia Cameron. Mm-hmm. She suggests writing 20 minutes of whatever thoughts come to your head without editing them in any way. You know, I've got to do the laundry, I have to grocery shop, whatever thoughts come to your head. But I've found it to be very helpful to become aware of whatever it is I'm thinking about. And she suggests doing it first thing in the morning, before you even have your coffee or anything, mm-hmm. before your editor, your quote-unquote editor, comes into your mind.
Right.
And you start blocking out the things that you are aware of, you know, when you first wake up.
So, in line with what you just said, if you look at the top of 17, the Holy Spirit's function is entirely communication. He therefore must remove whatever interferes with communication in order to restore it. So what you're talking about is just a way to look at whatever it is that's interfering with communication, right? Whatever the blocks are. And just see it. The morning is a good time. Any time is a good time. Right? Actually, I feel more inspired in the morning than any other time. I mean, it's really interesting to look at what your thoughts are as you're waking up. That's really interesting to just, what are the thoughts that are there? I woke up this morning composing a letter to somebody that I need to write. Yeah.
Sometimes I wake up and I know right away I'm an ego. Like, my eyes are open and already my thoughts are ego, ego, ego.
Sure.
And that prison looks pretty good. I want to go there.
What, really? To get quiet?
See, I'm having kind of like a reverse effect with the course. It's like when I'm home and I'm doing it alone and I'm meditating and I'm having communication with God, everything is good. Okay, then when I start to deal with people on the outside and other egos.
That's the challenge.
Yeah, it's a challenge. And where I'm at is suspicious at best, vicious at worst. That's how it's been the last month. Like, back to back to back, I was drawn into ego, and I really had to work hard to get out of it. Mm-hmm. And what's puzzling me is, like, I want to isolate. Like, I don't even want to deal with other people. And I know that's my ego, because the Course tells me that I have to, because we're all one, mm-hmm. and I can't get to heaven alone. But, like, I don't know. It's confusing to me.
Of course.
It's right now, it's hard for me, because I just want to, like, and I have, like, defriended a couple of people on Facebook. It's like, you know, I'm withering people out of my life, because I want the solitude to be able to do a course, okay. and be serious about it without having all these intrusions from other egos.
Right.
Help!
Okay, so hold on to it. So, even if that's true, then we want to be able to be in the world, but not of it. That's what the Course is saying. You know, that you're in the world, you see the other egos, you see the other dynamics, you see the play and the stuff. But it's not making you crazy. You're fine. And there's nothing wrong with cutting back on the frequency with which you're running, clashing up against other egos, or whatever it is that's happening there. The desire to get quiet is a wonderful desire. Because that's actually what Soren Kierkegaard once said, the whole of life is diseased. If I were a doctor and I would give my recommendation, I would say, create silence. Right? Just create the silence. So that's wonderful, creating the silence. But it's got to be real silence, not the crazy insanity, but the looking, just the watching.
Right.
Yes, honey. Wait, honey.
Get away.
You can't.
I'm wondering if I can find Soren Kierkegaard's
God using the word, thanks, using the word disease.
Uh-huh.
Dis-ease.
Dis-ease, yeah.
I mean, what was he talking about, illness or dis-ease?
He said the whole of the world. Mm-hmm. And what he was talking about, well, Kierkegaard lived from 15, he was in conflict with the Danish church over stuff that was going on, right? And he thought the whole society was diseased. He was what we think our first existentialist. By that I mean really the first kind of question person that says, what the hell is really going on here? Anyhow, I mean, so he was beginning to question his society and the world that he lived in. And he saw it as being diseased. It's that simple. Because it was just the belief system that was diseased. We all live in diseased belief systems.
Nowadays, we call it a cancer.
Yeah, you could call it. You know, you could call it that.
Continue to perpetuate.
Right.
The
remember
negativity.
That a few weeks ago, or months ago, I talked about a thing called Wetiko, which is this idea that the society is suffering from a kind of mass psychosis. Yeah. Which we see played out in war and politics. And Marianne, can you get Billy? No, there, you don't have it. It's Marianne's got it, which is what's needed.
Hi, I just wanted to respond to the lady who's having a difficult time.
Veronica,
because I think it's wonderful. I was really very happy to hear your struggle. Because in the course, it talks about you're right on track. You really are where you need to be in terms of your own progression. And I forget, John, what the reference is in the course, but there is a part where Jesus talks about the development as you go along the path. So mm-hmm. I just wanted to, yeah.
All right.
Thank you.
And as I think Brad was saying this morning, you know, we're always in the, wherever we're supposed to be is the right place to be as a part of this growth. The idea is to get the growth working in a very positive way for us so that it can feeds our soul and deepens us in the awareness that we have so we're no longer victims to, we no longer make ourselves victims to an insane world.
Right. Can I comment on that? And one other thing to be mindful of is when we start on this inward journey, it's inevitable that we're going to face a lot of discomfort because the guilt and the belief in sin and all the hateful thoughts and judgments that we project upon the world are deep within us, unconscious. So they have to come up. And it's in the coming up that is the great discomfort. But if we can look at that differently, to be grateful that they're coming up and that we have an opportunity to look at them, and once look at them, hand them over, that's the true definition of forgiveness, is to let it rise up, to look at it with the Holy Spirit, to give it to the Holy Spirit, and then we're free of it. So that process that's uncomfortable of the unconscious guilt and the judgments and hateful thoughts that are coming up, giving it over, we can look at that differently. So rather than being uncomfortable with it, we can be grateful that these things are being removed for us.
Very good. Thanks, Brad. Let's stop at this point and look at your cards. Anybody want to share your... and then we will need the mic for this on both sides. Here, let me have the mic.
The presence of fear is a sure sign that you are trusting in your own strength.
Hey, did y'all hear that? I didn't think so. The presence of fear is a sign that you're trusting in your own strength. Not a good one? Okay.
All anger is nothing more than an attempt to make someone feel guilty.
Yeah, all anger is nothing but an attempt to make somebody feel guilty. All anger, right? All attack thoughts, another way to say the same thing. Somebody else want to share your... here, let me give you the mic.
Put all your faith in the love of God within you, eternal, changeless, and forever, unfailing. This is the answer to whatever confronts you today.
Right. Wonderful, perfect, yeah. Anybody else on the... Oh, yeah. Yes.
No one created by God can find joy in anything except the eternal. Not because he is deprived of anything else, but because nothing else is worthy of him.
Right. So another way of saying that is that there's nothing on the outside that will ever be satisfying. It's only the inside. It's only the formless. It's only the love where any satisfaction will be found, or pleasure for that matter either. Anybody else? How about this side? George.
With love in you, you have no need except to extend it.
Isn't that great? No need to do anything but love, but extend it. Anybody else on this side? Eileen?
Forget not the kingdom of God for anything the world has to offer.
See, and notice how similar all these, the theme is, right? There's nothing in the world that has value for us to offer. Anybody else on this side? Diana?
If you cannot hear the voice for God, it is because you do not choose to listen.
What did I say earlier today that Helen said the whole purpose of the course was? Learning how to listen to the Holy Spirit, right? Right. Anybody, Robert, here.
Good afternoon, everybody. Yeah. All things work together for good. There are no exceptions except in the ego's judgment.
All right. Again, Brad and I were talking in the car coming up that Brad was saying that more and more he realizes that regardless of what happens, it's really the right thing in the world. Even the things that we say, why the hell did this happen? And this doesn't fit into my story and my plan. But here it is. Later on, you see why it did. It was perfectly a part of your plan. Especially, it's true of the things you get older, and you look back through the spectrum, and you see how all of those misfortunes were actually the right choices that you thought were wrong, that the wrong thing was going on at the time. Anybody else? Marianne.
It is quite possible to listen to God's voice all through the day without interrupting your regular activities in any way. The part of your mind in which truth abides is in constant communication with God, whether you are aware of it or not.
The other part of your mind is constantly distracted, and I'm just kind of quoting it, but that's where it goes. It's confused, upset, pulled in by the world, right? Okay, let's do a meditation for minutes. You want to just sit comfortably. This is a modification of lesson 193, which is in keeping with what I just got to saying. So take a couple of deep breaths and relax and be quiet, be present, eyes closed or open, whatever you want to do. All things are lessons God would have me learn. I will forgive, and this will disappear. These are the words to speak in any tribulation. These are the words which, when temptation end, guilt is abandoned and revered no more. These are the words which end the dream of sin and rid the mind of fear. These are the words by which salvation comes to all the world. I will forgive, and this will disappear. Say these words whenever you're tempted to believe that pain is real, and death becomes our choice instead of life. These words have the power to release all minds from bondage. These words apply to everything you see or any brother looks upon amiss. I will forgive, and this will disappear. How can you tell when you are seeing wrong or someone else is failing to perceive the lesson he should learn? Does pain seem real in the perception? If it does, there remains an unforgiveness hiding in the mind. Forgive, and you will see this differently. There is a way to look on everything that lets it be to you another step to the salvation of the world. To all that speak of terror, answer thus, I will forgive, and this will disappear. So be it. And if you will, turn to the, take your little booklet and turn to the back of the booklet. And we'll share together in reading together the what's called the Lord's Prayer from the Course. And we pause at every comma and stop at every period. Forgive us our illusions, Father, and help us to accept our true relationship with you, in which there are no illusions and where none can ever enter. Our holiness is yours. What can there be in us that needs forgiveness when yours is perfect? The sleep of forgetfulness is the only unwillingness to remember your forgiveness and your love. Let us not wander into temptation, for the temptation of the Son of God is not your will. And let us receive only what you have given, and accept but this into the mind, which you created and which you love. So for those who want to join us, we have reservations at the Saigon Market on University Place, just two blocks to the right on 12th, and then one block, not less than a block, just a little ways down on the left. The next class is December the 14th. As he said, there's going to be a little reception thing afterwards. And it's interesting, the next class is December, and it just so happens it covers the part in the course about Christmas. So we'll, just coincidentally, we'll be looking at that Christmas. So I'll see you in December.